We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
There's no combination of words I could put on the back of a postcard. No song that I could sing, but I can try for your heart.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Pathways to Love. I am your host, Julie Orlov, and I am delighted to spend another Sunday afternoon with you on this beautiful LA Talk Live radio station. I have been doing this work for over 25 years as a psychotherapist, an executive coach, speaker, and the author of the Pathway to Love's books and programs. And we are here every week dedicated to helping you create very strong and intimate relationships in every area of your life. And today, I'm really excited about our topic today because it really takes a look at the aspect of relationships that we don't necessarily talk about all the time. And that is about making your dreams come true. And while that can include finding that love of your life, yes, that could be one of the dreams you're wanting to make true, but we don't want to keep it to that. We really want to talk about what it is to have big dreams, small dreams, your dreams, keep those dreams alive, go after those dreams, and make those dreams a reality, and at the same time, support the dreams of the people that you love. So how does dream building and dream making dreams come true work out within the context of your relationships? It's really important because you don't want your dreams to go away just because you have a relationship, and you don't want a relationship to stop you from going from your dreams. So that is our topic today. And I am delighted to have a very special guest with us. And she, out of everyone I know, certainly know what it's like to have big dreams, to go for those dreams and make those dreams come true. So I first want to introduce Nadine Lajoie. Did I get that right?
Yes.
All right. Welcome, Nadine.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm really pleased today.
And I'll tell the audience a little bit about you, but then I want you to kind of fill in the gaps because you have lived an exciting life, one that I think is unique. Not most women out there have lived your life. Nadine is a champion motorcycle racer, and we're going to hear about that. She's also an award-winning entrepreneur, and she has just accomplished quite a bit. She's a speaker. She's American's high-speed success coach. And Nadine was retired and was a millionaire at the age of 41, became the champion motorcycle racer who sings like an angel. So on top of it, she's also a very talented singer. And we are so lucky that today we're actually going to get to hear you. So I'm very excited about that. And also a radio host herself and co-founder of Teen CEO Reality TV Show. So she's done... You've accomplished quite a bit already in your life, and I know you have a lot to teach people when it comes to achieving your goals and dreaming big and making those dreams come true. So tell me, let's hear a little bit about, I mean, we can't help but hear about it. When did you decide that you needed to race motorcycles? Because looking at you, you wouldn't know it. You know
what
I mean?
Yeah, yeah. And the thing is, I was a volleyball player until... the year 2000, and I broke my knee 5 times, and I was I finished like 9 in a national championship in Canada, and that was my dream, that was my goal, my passion at that time. Music and volleyball was my 2 passions to save my life. So in 2000, I had to have a surgery, and I wasn't sure if I would be able to play at the top level anymore. Mm-hmm. Top 10 in Canada, that was not so bad. So I said, okay, what can I do? And I always wanted to have a motorcycle. I made my dad buy a motorcycle when I was 16 years old. I dropped the bike the first time I drove it, so I never got my driver's license. And I said, okay, I will buy a motorcycle. So I bought a motorcycle for my gift, for my surgery, put that in the living room with Christmas tree, Christmas lights and all that for all the winter until the year after. And 2 years later, I was crazy on the street, and my friend said, you will kill yourself, so go on the racetrack.
If you're gonna kill yourself, make it count.
Yeah, no, it's because the street is a lot more dangerous than right. on the racetrack. Because right, on the racetrack, everybody goes in the same way,
right?
And it's a safe environment. There is no telephone pole or right. other cars or kids or animals.
Right. So. Right. Yeah, I think other cars are the biggest hazard to motorcycle. motorcycle drivers. So, okay, so you, obviously, you've been a competitor your whole life. And so going for dreams, like having big dreams and going for them, that comes naturally to you, I would imagine. Is that correct?
Now that comes naturally, but it didn't at that time. It's a matter of having habit and having the discipline. And I want to share with you and your listener the five secrets of a high achiever. That needs focus. So when I was playing piano since I was 5 years old, I was playing piano 1 hour and a half a day, 2 hours a day. So the focus, the adrenaline. So what makes you excited? And in a relationship, that is exactly the same thing. Because if you are not excited in the morning when you get up, or if you are not excited to come back home, it cannot work.
Right.
So it's
And it takes that focus too. That daily, you know, daily attention.
Yes.
And care. Just like any other goal. Yeah. Absolutely.
So focus, adrenaline, discipline. So do the stuff. And as you said, like in a relationship, it's just nurturing the relationship every morning, every day. It's there is nothing that can stop in anything in your life, in business, in relationship, in health, in a physical body, in emotional, spiritual, everything needs discipline.
I would totally agree with you. And I think that's the hardest part, because people get very, you can get very excited about a dream or something you feel passionate about. And then the reality starts to kick in. It's like, oh, this is going to take work. You know, it's really, it's going to take some consistent effort. And the thing that kills me, which is, and I'm just thinking of like getting in shape, because, you know, I know how hard it is for me to actually get in shape. And then I swear to God, you know, it takes like 2-3 weeks. And I'm not back to square one, but it doesn't take much to slip back. Do you find that's also the case in most people's efforts to reach their
dreams?
Yes.
And I'm coaching a lot of people in their business and their life. And the people have a tendency to give up. Because one that needs that effort, that discipline, that practice, having different coaches, mentors, because people, we think that we know it. And often we know it, but we don't apply it.
Right.
And that's the thing with if you want to be a high achiever, you really need to go forward all the time.
Right.
And in every aspect of your life.
Right. It's so true. And it just reminds me of that when I work with people, whether it's a therapist or as a coach on their relationships, it's the same thing. It's not that most people know what it takes to make a relationship work. They know it takes time. It knows it takes kindness. You know, you got to communicate it in a certain way. I mean, there isn't much, you know, that, but it's so hard to take what you know and translate it into action. I mean, that's, you know, to know something and then to act accordingly, that's a huge leap for some people in some areas. So kind of what's your strategy when you're working with people that, yeah, I know this is what I need to do, and there's something that stops them from actually being able to do it?
I think there is two things that we need to master. And I would say, like in business in general, it's having a transactional, like a money, a plan, a system. So the transactional, like the physical thing, and you need the transformational. The transformation and discover your own power inside yourself. And you need to balance both. And you need to be masculine and you need to be feminine at the same time. Or you need to have a lot of energy, like me, motorcycle racing at 180 miles per hour against guys, finishing third at Daytona against 75 guys. And at the same time, and at the same time, I was meditating and doing my bubble of protection around my bike. So the spiritual side with the adrenaline. So I think when people can join both and master both together, and that is the same thing in a relationship. And I would say an example, like if you want your relationship really working, the transactional part would be, okay, having maybe a dinner every week or little attention. Like it's something physical that really feeds each other. But at the same time, if the relationship doesn't fill your soul and your heart, it cannot work.
Right.
And it's always the balance in life, and it's always a challenge to and being able to bring both together.
Right. Well, and it's also that balance of in relationships, you're also, you know, I need to focus on my partner's needs. I need to also make sure I'm still in my own power and I'm aware of what my own needs are. And how much can, you know, do I rely? How much of my needs are met by someone else versus how much of my needs do am I 100% responsible for? You know, it's really also, and I like what you said about, I think it takes a team. And I think, honestly, the bigger the goal, the bigger game you're playing, so to speak, the bigger team you need to have around you. And that doesn't mean that your team is there, everyone's there at one moment in time. It may be this person you pull in at this moment of your career or at this moment of your relationship, and then things move on and, you know, let's say your business has reached a certain level, you're going to pull in another type of coach, an expert, or you now have kids and you're going to pull in, you know, different other people that help you and your family and how your family grows and gets nurtured over time. So I think it's really important that I think here in particular, we have this concept that we just are supposed to do it. You know, we just like toughen up and just do it.
Especially for women, because in a job market, we really need to push and push and push to get the same recognition or the same acknowledgement than the guys. It's still like that in 2013, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. But we kind of, and I had that tendency too, to let out my feminine side,
right,
my intuition.
Right.
Because in business, it's business, and you don't think about your intuition. But again, it's really bringing both together, and that's where it's worthy.
Mm-hmm. And I think it's really it's a very important thing that you say, particularly for the women out there, because yes, there's something about bringing in your masculine side when you're going for something or you're climbing the career ladder. But at the same time, there's value. There's so much value in that feminine side and bringing that balance that I think it's important to honor who you are. And I'm fascinated to hear how this worked on a motorcycle. Because first of all, I mean, were you the only female or how many females were there?
Probably on each racetrack, we were between 5 to 7 women on the racetrack against probably 400, 500 guys.
Oh, so my God. It's like, so you're like 1%.
And I was top 10 woman probably in North America at one point. So I was at 0.01% of my field.
So you've had the experience of really being in a man's world. So one, it's an interesting journey of how did they accept you or did they accept you? That's, I guess, a question mark.
They find that pretty cool having a chick at the racetrack until you pass them.
Right. And did you have to play it by their rules, or were you able, like you say, you know, to bring in maybe some of that instinct and the intuition and bringing in, you know, some of the more typical, I put this in quote, you know, they're feminine qualities, but I mean that more energetically, not necessarily gender.
To motorcycle racing and even in the business, because I own 6 businesses now, that feminine side, often, even me, I forget it because we are so go, go, go. Mm-hmm. But once you know different tools and different strategies, and that's what I'm helping also my clients to do, it's bringing that feminine. And I really need to focus every day. Mm-hmm. Every day on, okay, what did I do today that I could have done better? And often it's because I was too masculine.
Yeah.
So now I really work on my feminine side.
Well, and I would assume if you coach men that you would do just the same for them, like help them bring in the balance, you know, perspective.
Because for men too, the feminine side is for everybody.
Right.
And it's not just the feminine. It's the softness. It's the authenticity. Because guys, a guy who is crying on the racetrack, you never barely see that. But women who were crying on the racetrack, okay, we are pissed off and we are doing it. You
right.
know? It's, yeah. And for me, I'm not shy about that. I'm not ashamed about that.
Right. Interesting. Okay. And one of the things we were talking about before the show, I know, is we were talking about, you know, the direction of our conversation, where we wanted to kind of start. One of the things I felt is so important is that people have their dreams. And let's just start with people who are single, because I think there's different challenges that go if you're in a relationship or you're out of a relationship. But if you're out of a relationship, I know men and women, I hear this all the time. Well, I'm really, you know, working on my career, or I have this huge goal to record albums, or, you know, whatever that dream is. And they feel like they can't go for their dreams and have a relationship at the same time. Like somehow they don't have enough energy or they've got to put all their focus on here. So I'm curious of what your thoughts are about it. And especially, you know, if you had any experience with that, since you are so goal oriented, what was that like for you?
It's not always easy. And I would say in a balance of life, it's probably my weakness, the relationship, because when I was a financial planner, I built my financial business. I was in a relationship for 9 years. And it's always about pushing each other. Mm-hmm. So until you push each other in the direction of your dreams, the couple can continue, I think. If not, you either have to let go your dream or let go your relationship. Unless you are able to both push in the same boat, like doing
well, if
this
you can
the
support
same way.
Yeah, if you can support each other.
But because I had now 6 businesses, like I had to give up a little bit on the relationship portion to really build that. I came from Canada in 2007. I didn't speak English. I built my real estate business here, built my network, right, and knew a lot of people and built my speaking, coaching career and my books in 5 years. So accomplishing all that in the last 5 years, I really had to give up on the relationship part. Now that my business is doing well and everything is kind of set up, now it's more time to take more time for myself and for more time also for a relationship.
Yeah, I think it's interesting. And, there's this push and this belief. And I hear it all the time. Whereas, okay, if you're an entrepreneur, and I'm an entrepreneur, you know, entrepreneurs work 18 hours a day, you know, that's what it takes. And I always say, well, that's not necessarily true. You know, you can be an entrepreneur and you can also say, you know, this is the amount of time. It's really more time. It's energy, too. But, you know, this is what I want to put into this business. And this is what I want to put into other areas of my life. Now, I don't know the outcome. It'd probably be an interesting study. It may mean that the business takes 5 years to get off the ground and maybe not 2. You know, mm-hmm. or maybe if you have a partner that you're in relationship with who supports you, you know, that person is there and you have more freedom, like they don't need as much time with you, you know. So I think there's all kinds of parameters in how to work this. And I think people get sometimes locked in a box where they think it's only all or nothing. It's only this or that, or that there aren't other variations. Plus, I just think the bottom line is that everybody has to make their choice of what works for them. I mean, that's the bottom line.
Yeah, and I really believe it's possible to have both. Mm-hmm. And when it fits with your bigger vision. Because I'm a really big vision woman, you know, I want to speak and sing in front of 100,000 people at the same time in 2014. I want to create a week awareness against suicide and depression. My mission hit me in 2007 when I was semi-retired. So because my mission became like a lot bigger than myself, like too big and even scary to mm-hmm. have that mission, it's why you cannot grow 2 things at the same time because the mission become too big.
Right.
But once you get used to it, like motorcycle, when you start to roll and you start to be comfortable, oh, now you can take the time to do both at the same time. And again, it's a lot of limiting belief because I know so many people who are so successful in different businesses, having wonderful relationship, wonderful kids, wonderful family, and they spend a lot of time with their family. My right. family is in Quebec, so right. I barely see them once or twice a year, but it's really important, I think, to focus on both.
Yeah, I think it's very interesting because I would say even when I was having children and raising small children, I had to make some choices. And I thought, well, you know what? I want to be there when school is out. Like, I want to be able to pick them up from school and have that kind of lifestyle as a mom. And there were some sacrifices. My career could grow at a certain point, but I knew this was probably about all that it could because mm-hmm. there's just only so much capacity. And that as my children grew up, I could then put more of my attention back on career. And everybody has their own different package of how they make that work for them. But I think it's interesting that there are some people that will put off, they'll put off their relationship needs to focus on their dreams and their goals. And then there are some people who will put off their goals and their career goals, you know, or those kinds of dreams until after they have a family and that and their children are more grown. So, yeah, I always wonder, you know, is there a way where you can feel like you're not sacrificing anything? You know,
and I think the way to not sacrificing is really having your plan. And that's why I build a racing system to your dreams. And I share that on my book. So I want to share the 6 step for your listener, because if you want to have balance, you need to have 3 different aspects of your life, your personal, your professional and your spiritual. Mm-hmm. If you work on these 3 all together through these 6 steps, and you have really a good plan, and I have a vision board and a 12-quarter trimester plan, mm-hmm. that's where the people can accomplish many things at the same time. And that's what I did in my life. I accomplished so many things.
Right, right.
And when I started to be a coach and a speaker a few years ago, I said, okay, what can I bring to the people? Something really easy, really quick. And this is the acronym of RACING.
Okay.
So the R is for recognize your finish line. Recognize which kind of relationship you want in your personal, professional, spiritual. And you can work on that in many different ways. The A is for act. One corner at a time, like motorcycle racing. When you're in corner one, you just focus on corner one. When you're on corner two, you focus on corner two. So it's a step, it's a quick step process that you need to know in these 3 areas again.
Okay, so let me just kind of go back and reiterate that. So the R is recognize your end line.
Yes.
So you really want to know what it is that you're after. So if you want to be married, let's say, mm-hmm. and that's really important to you, then know that you want to be married. So you don't want to date someone who has no interest in being married, for example.
Actually, yeah.
Okay. Or if you want to have children, if that's really important to you. Or if you just want to have a companion that's just fun, like you don't want to live with anybody, you yeah. just want to have fun, that's fine too. So you want to know that in sight. And then the A is it really sounds like that really speaks to being present. Like in the moment, like don't jump too far
in
ahead.
The moment and having action plan.
Okay.
So like you said, if you want to get married, your action plan is first finding somebody who wants to get married. Don't hang out with people who doesn't want to get married. So what are the action steps you can take?
Okay.
And as far as your relationship, what are the action plan? And with your boyfriend or with your girlfriend, what are their goals? So if their dreams is not fitting with their dreams, at some point it will probably not match.
Right. If their dream is to settle down in the middle of Montana and fish, you know what I mean? That's their dream. And your dream, and they want to fish with you. and your dream is to travel the world singing on stage. That's going to be a bit of a problem.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
So that's why the aid is the action is really like the day-to-day, the reality. Mm-hmm. We need to deal with reality. that's fun to be in our dream, but right. we need to deal with the day-to-day.
Right.
So the C is care about yourself, your family, your business, your relationship. What are the steps in your personal, professional, spiritual, again, you need to take care of? Mm-hmm. And the I is empower. And that is a word that I invent because of my French-Canadian English accent. I didn't speak English in 2007. Inspire and empower was sounding the same. Uh-huh. And I wanted to also communicate the go inside yourself and discover your power, which right. I did.
Right.
And because in 95, I almost committed suicide. And I was negative and really sad and really mad. And my life changed mm-hmm. since that. So the empower, since I discovered that power and that desire to live mm-hmm. again, so that's where you can really accomplish so much more when you really know your power.
Well, yeah, and you have to know your power and you have to know how to not give it away.
Yeah.
Because I think that's what gets people into trouble. You know, they get scared. They feel like, you know, they get too attached to whatever and then they give their power away.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's really important. Very good.
And the N is for never give up. So whatever right. challenges you have, if that fits with your goal and if you're taking the right action, don't give up. Mm-hmm. If the goal change, maybe you need to give up. But it's not a giving up. It's really a readjusting your course or your path.
Right.
But if you are really clear and it's hard and it's challenging, but it's really true to your mission, your passion, and your relationship, don't give up.
Right. Right. And I think that that's also where people can get confused. I think that
you're right.
There's that balance between knowing the, you know, knowing what you're going after and going after it, and also having the wisdom to pay attention to what may be right in front of you that you can't see because you're so busy looking at what you think you're supposed to be finding. Do you know what I mean? So it's you know, like, for example, I have a friend who really all his life wanted to be an actor. Okay. So finally, he left his marriage. You know, he thought, okay, this is a time I'm going to devote all my energy to acting. Okay. And he was that initial excitement. I can do it. I can do it. And he was putting all the, and then, you know, realities hit, you know, it's not happening quite as quickly. It's not happening in the way that, you know, he, and he's doing his due diligence. I mean, it's not like he's not, he's putting in the work, but it's, you know, you only have control over so much. You don't have control over your entire universe, you know?
Yeah.
So then it was like, well, okay, you know, maybe I need to get a job in the meantime because I need to eat and I need to pay my bills and I need to be a responsible citizen. And I'll still do that acting. I'll still go after acting, but it's going to look a little bit different than I thought.
Yeah.
You know, and I think it's important for people to know that just because you have, you know, I saw a great diagram. I'm sure people have seen it.
Oh, yeah.
Where it talks about the road to success.
Yes.
And it says something like, this is our expectations of success. This is what we think success looks like. And it has that, well, if I try and get with the camera, it's going this way, right? It's just a nice little, there we go. And then it shows the real road to success. And it's like, you know, and it's like all over the place.
Yes.
And that's, and a lot of time that's what it looks like. And yet it, there's all kinds of interesting things you find along the way.
Yeah.
And it may even at the end of the day show up differently than you thought.
Oh, yeah. And it's always different than you thought.
Exactly.
Like, I wanted to be an actuary. So like traveling and showing people about mathematics and pension plans and all that. It didn't work out. Finally, I become a financial planner, which I didn't want to at the beginning. And finally, because of that, 11 years later, I was able to accomplish my dreams, which is speaking and singing.
Right.
But it didn't come like the 20 years ago when I wanted to do. But now it's coming 20 years later because I learned a lot about the heart and the soul, which I would not have done that 20 years ago. If that would have been easy, I would not have become the person I am right now.
Yeah, I think sometimes it's trusting the timing of life because you can't control timing. You just, you know, it's one of those things that you're just in the right place at the right time. It's, you know, it's at this, you know, it's that synchronicity. It's the nice surprises that life gives us. And so I love that you bring both those things to your work with people. There really is the responsible, disciplined work aspect of it, that you have a goal, you need a plan, you need to work the plan, you need to bring support in to help you work the plan. All those things are in place. And there's that other piece where, you know, patience and being open-minded to where life may take you that may be different, and it could be even better than what you had thought up for yourself.
Yeah, it's probably always better, even if we don't think about it
at the
moment.
Right.
Like I said, sometimes it can take weeks or months or years, but we hear so many people who have a cancer or a big breakup or a bankruptcy, and they say, oh my God, that is the best thing happened in my life. Right. Or they lost their arm. Or I said, oh my God, I'm always impressed and I'm always like inspired and excited to see people, how they turn a challenge into an opportunity. And that is the way to success, turning a challenge to an opportunity in any ways.
Right. And a no, or this didn't work, is not a failure. I don't know, who was it? There was somebody, I can't remember who it was, someone who said, you have to fail your way to success, so to speak, you know?
Failing forward.
Yeah, I like that. Failing forward, I like that. Because people, again, they can get stopped so easily where they feel like, oh no. And I just, again, the big picture, like the big, I always use this in therapy. You've got two perspectives and they're both equally important. And the key is to know when to zone in, like a camera lens. You know, you either go wide angle or you go right into the shot. And it's that way with life. Do you zone into the bigger picture to say, you know, be patient. In the big scheme of things, your life is going to be, it's just going to be fine.
Yeah.
And to know when to zone in, like you say, to, okay, I got this nasty turn coming. I got this cycle next to me. I'm crunched in. I'm going 180 miles an hour. Yeah. I need to do something now. Yeah. Like, you don't want to take a wide view at that point, yeah. I don't think.
And that's what motorcycle teach me a lot, about that focus when you have 20,000 things at the same time, and you can see on the picture the eyes of somebody with focus. And if we would live our life like it is the last day,
yeah,
what would you do?
Yeah, you wouldn't waste your time over petty stuff.
Yes.
You'd pay attention to the stuff that really counts.
Yeah.
And you probably would relax a little bit. I would take a nap. But
I would go to the pool and the beach.
I would fit in a nap. All right. We're going to take a break. I forgot to give out the phone number. So let me do that now. So when we come back from break. Oh, and we have a special. We have special things. Okay, there's so much to do. Let's just take this a step at a time. First of all, if you want to join in this conversation, we would love to hear from you. So please give us a call. The studio number is 323-473-3100. That's 323-473-3100. And our treat, as I know that we've talked about, Nadine is an unbelievable singer. Your talents just keep flowing and flowing and flowing.
Thank you.
Oh my gosh. Anyways, we are in for a treat because she's going to sing our way onto a break. So, and what are we hearing?
The song is Don't Stop Believing. That is a song I really love because it really think about always believe in yourself and believe in your dream and just do it.
That's a great journey song. Love that song. All right, here we go.
Thank you. Just a small town girl living in a lonely world. She took the midnight train going anywhere. Just a city boy born and raised in South Detroit. He took the midnight train going anywhere. A singer in a smoky room, a smell of wine and cheap perfume. For a smile it can share the night. It goes on and on and on and on. Strangers waiting up and on a boulevard. There's shadows searching in the night. People living just to fight emotion, hiding somewhere in the night.
We're off.
I'm Ro Williams, and I would like to invite you to join GospelRhythms.com every Sunday at 4 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for our show, GospelRhythms.com Talk Live Radio. Join us as we celebrate Christians around the world in all genres of entertainment, as well as highlight interest stories on men and women who are making a difference and impacting their community. So don't forget to tune in to GospelRhythms.com Talk Live Radio exclusively on LATalkLive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes under R&B or watch us live on Ustream TV. We are reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is GospelRhythms.com Talk Live Radio on LATalkLive.com. We're more than just talk. We're heaven's party here on earth.
Hey, hey, shout us out. What's the count? I'm your host, Ferran Dozier. I'm inviting you to join me on WDC Radio every Monday at 11 a.m. Pacific Standard Time as we discuss community topics around health, sports, and entertainment. So don't forget to shout us out. What's the count? On WDC Radio, only on LATalkLive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio, R&B, or watch us on Ustream.tv. Reality radio, handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we're more than just talk. What's the count?
Hi, I'm Ro Williams, and I would like to invite you to join GospelRhythms.com every Sunday at 4 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for our show, GospelRhythms.com Talk Live Radio. Join us as we celebrate Christians around the world in all genres of entertainment, as well as highlight interest stories on men and women who are making a difference and impacting their community. So don't forget to tune in to GospelRhythms.com Talk Live Radio exclusively on LATalkLive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes under R&B or watch us live on Ustream TV. We are reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is GospelRhythms.com Talk Live Radio on LATalkLive.com. We're more than just talk. We're heaven's party here on earth.
Okay, well, welcome back, everyone. So this has just been a lovely, lovely treat. Thank you for your beautiful voice and that song. It's a great song.
Thank you.
Okay, you are watching. We're back with Pathways to Love. I'm your host, Julie Orlov. I am here with Nadine Lajoie. God, I got that down. I'm going back to, you know, I took French. I was telling you, I took French in college. I had the worst pronunciation of anybody in the class. It was really embarrassing.
Don't worry, I failed my English class.
Yeah, but see, here's the thing. I will tell you this. Having a French accent with English, like, sounds really good. But an English accent trying to speak French, no. It just doesn't work so well the other way. So I think your accent, you can just get away in just about every country on the planet. So it's just such a beautiful accent.
Thanks.
All right. So we are talking about making your dreams a reality and supporting the dreams of those that you love. And during the break, we were talking a little bit about, okay, so many, everyone has dreams. I just don't care who you are. When you're a little boy and you're a little girl, you have dreams about what you want to be when you grow up or what you want your life to be. And I don't think that ever stops. But people get shut down pretty quick in their dreams. So can you speak to that a little bit? What's been your experience working with people in terms of they've got a dream and it's been shut down either by themselves or by someone else?
Yeah, I can talk about my own experience. I have many stories about that. But one of my first ones, because I was a musician since 5 years old, a pianist, and I started to sing. And I was really a bad singer at the beginning, so it took a few years. I wanted to be a singer, like in a celebrity. And even in 84, when Celine Dion came to sing for the Pope, uh-huh. I really wanted to go. And I finally went, and I was wishing she will be sick. So like that, I can raise my hand and sing for the Pope instead of Celine Dion.
Gotta love the fantasy life. It's
so great. And at that time, I think I was shut down by my family, my friends, the people, because they said, oh, who are you to want to be a singer and all that. And I think if we listen to the naysayer, we will never go anywhere. And me, my reaction to everybody who told me I cannot do something, like even the motorcycle racing, for sure, right. My parents are not agreeing on that, for
right.
sure. And even on volleyball, I'm 5'1". So people told
I
me,
know.
You cannot do that. And
wow.
when people tell you cannot do that, you have two ways to react. Either you comply with them and you
right.
kind of agree and you say, oh, yeah, maybe you're right. Maybe I'm not good enough. Maybe I cannot do that. I don't have enough money. I'm too old. I'm too young. I don't speak English, because a lot of people told me I will never be on radio or on TV because of my accent. Oh. I barely spoke English. So and the second way to react is really do it anyway. Show the other people
right.
you can do it.
Right.
And for me, it really paid off a lot. And for a lot of people who are successful when you read their biography or when you see them on stage or things like that. Everybody were just going anyway.
So what do you tell, I agree, I think you tend to go two ways. You either get really small and you feel like, oh yeah, you're right, because it feeds in all your own self-doubts, because everybody's got those as well.
Yeah.
Not everybody, but I'd say 99% of the people out there. So I think it's really easy to do that. And that other part where you're going to say, well, I'll just show you.
Okay. Yeah.
So how do you get the person who can start to, you know, just kind of shrink down and all that excitement just drains from them? How do you get them to swing over to the other side, or at least start to move in that direction? What's something that people can do when they hear that? Or what do you do to help people?
Yeah. What I do, what I said at the beginning, it's the transformational part.
Right.
So I really work a lot on myself between 99 and 2004. Because I kind of lost my self-confidence. And as I said, I wanted to commit suicide. So even if I was good at everything, sports, at music, good parents, I could not do it because I was lacking of confidence. So it's why everybody needs a coach. Everybody needs a mentor. And I got probably 30, 35 different coaches and mentor. Les Brown is one of them. And it's you need to stop listening to naysayer. And you really need to focus on somebody who is really there for you, who is really kind of giving you the hand and just bringing you in. And refocus on your confidence, on your power, on your passion. And sometimes just writing in the journal at night, your qualities, or your power, everything you did right during the day. Mm-hmm. And the problem with people, when we do journaling, we have a tendency to write the negative stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And really, we need to never do that at night. You can do that during the day, but at night, it's all about recognizing and being grateful. Like, write your five things you are grateful today.
Right. You want to go to sleep with that positive,
yeah,
that message and that energy going, yeah, into your subconscious.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And the other tool that I really use a lot with my clients is that vision board, that, mm-hmm, dream board with the, mm-hmm, picture, with, mm-hmm, the little pins for each, mm-hmm, action you do.
Mm-hmm.
Because your subconscious is focusing on the action, even if it's small action. Now you kind of get a momentum.
Right.
And to realize your dream, that's what you need.
Right.
You need just a little encouragement at the beginning, and you just like you just move forward a little bit. You're meeting another person who are just giving you the hand. Oh, now you're moving. And it's only after getting the momentum that you really kind of rebuild your confidence and your light inside yourself.
Right. I think that's perfect. And I love the idea that you want to exchange the people who are saying, no, you can't do it, for the cheerleaders in your life. And to find someone that has, you know, that's, and so that you can, they can be a role model, they can be your inspiration, to surround yourself by people who are saying, yeah, of course you can do it, you know, and here, let me help you with this one little thing. You know, that's how people get sick. No one does it on their own. There's always somebody who's been in that place before and is giving back, or,
yes,
giving forward, however you want to,
yes,
call it. I know for myself, I get calls all the time from therapists that are just graduating, let's say, their graduate school programs or whatever they need. And they want to meet with me. And they want to see how do you do it? How did you make this work and all this stuff? And, I'll meet with people all the time because I remember what it was like to get,
yeah,
started. And you needed someone who can says, you know, let me give you some suggestions. Let me give you some people that are great contacts. I mean, that's really... It's so important to do that.
And that is really, really cool that you bring that up, because people who are mentor or who are coaches, when somebody wants to follow our step, we are there to give back.
That's
we are
right.
there to go lunch with them and spend time, because I had many, many people who spend time with me.
That's right.
But the problem is, even when I was a financial planner, sometimes people were canceling their investment or whatever because their brother-in-law or sister-in-law told them, oh, you should not do that. Or when I wanted to write my book, When the Race of Life,
uh-huh,
people discouraged me. But the, right, people who were discouraging me were the people who never had a book in their life.
Right.
So always take the advice from the people who did it. right. who've been there, done that. So that's why I restarted to coach. And now I coach over 800 clients in my life before. And I kind of stopped coaching.
Right.
But because a lot of people like you, they are calling me. And it's all about giving back.
Yeah, it's really important to do that. And the other piece of advice, I can just speak for myself, because I remember I always wanted to be on radio. Like having my own radio show was something that was, and I always said, this isn't the right time. You know, later.
It's never the right time anyway.
Right, of course. But I remember looking at all these people with this level of success and saying, well, what is it? You know, what is it that they have that I don't? And then it finally clicked to me, and the word was nothing. It's like, you know, if you look at, I don't care how far you go, you can look up someone as Barack Obama, all the, you know, to, I don't know, I hate to use Donald Trump, but some people will use him, but all these very successful people, however you define success, because it isn't always monetary. There's a lot of different ways to define success, but whoever is one you want to emulate, They're no different than you, you know. They had that they had to be potty trained just like you.
Yeah.
You know, they still had mothers that they had you know, a bedtime. They still went to school. They still, you know, they still had a job, and they still had to work their way into wherever they are in their lives today.
Yeah.
And I think it's really important to really acknowledge that everybody on this planet, you know, everyone has what it takes. Yeah. It's just
everybody is a leader inside themselves.
Exactly. So it's finding the life that works for you. I think it's the one that you want. And I think that's also really important, because you don't want to have naysayers talking you out of something, but you also don't want to have people talking you into something that also isn't true to you. I think the opposite can happen
as
well.
Yeah, absolutely.
With the Pathway to Love, with the books and the programs and all that, I was getting a lot of pressure on, well, this is how you have to market. And it was doing it a certain way that I could not get on board with. And I know a lot of people are really successful marketing and selling their stuff in a certain way. And I just said, you know, it doesn't work for me. And as much as I tried to pay attention to people who had done it and succeeded it and followed a certain formula, I just finally I had to say, no, you know what? It doesn't matter.
It needs to fit with your value
exactly,
at the same time.
Exactly. And I think so. There's so many things that have to be in alignment. And I think when it is in alignment, that's where your journey takes off. Does that sound?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And even when you are a leader, because everybody should be a leader. You are a leader in your family. You are a leader somewhere in some way.
That's right.
But when you are a leader, often, if you are really creative like I am or like many other people, you don't have nobody to show you the way because you are a leader. So mm-hmm. you just find some other people who are really close to you or do different stuff.
Yeah.
And you just take a combination of whatever fits for you.
Yeah.
And if it doesn't fit, like you said, you just run away.
Yeah, because there's not one way to there's not one path
no.
towards anything.
Yeah.
Oh my God. I mean, if you had followed the path that probably the average 17-year-old who was born in Canada,
no,
you wouldn't be where you are. No. I know that
even,
for sure.
Even when I said that I wanted to speak and sing and bring people at the racetrack, like I'm doing business seminars at the racetrack and bring people
that.
On the back of the bike, everybody told me that I was crazy. It's not possible. Like since 2 years, I was working on that. And because I'm stubborn, and it's one quality you need to get. And as an entrepreneur is being stubborn.
Yeah,
and you kind of just push it. And finally, I did my two-word premiere this summer, and everybody is so excited about it. But everybody was discouraging me 2 years ago.
Yeah. See, isn't that funny? Yeah. You call it stubborn. I call it tenacious. I like
tenacious.
Tenacious. Sounds so much better. Yeah. I have a daughter who's got tenacity beyond belief. And I always look at her and say, oh, you're going to be successful whatever you do, because you just have so much tenacity. Nothing stops you.
That's where you get success.
Yeah. Of course, she's exhausted me as her mother. But, you know, can you imagine? No doesn't really mean known in her world. So I know you can relate to that, too.
Yeah.
I can probably relate to your mother, how she probably felt. So, all right. So here's the other piece that I just want to bring into. So it's really important to have people in your life that support you in your dreams and understand that that aren't also waiting for you to fall. I just can't stand that when people have people in their life so that they can just say, oh, I told you so, because it's too threatening to them. It's like it kind of pushes their own, why am I not going after my dreams, in my face? I think that's a lot of what it does. Yeah. So there's actually, when you think about it, there's a lot of obstacles to overcome to really be on the path that's right for you. I mean, you really have to be, I think, committed and determined to it. Okay, but now it's also equally important that you be that supportive person to the people in your life that you love and that you care about that have their dreams. And that can also be scary because you can be that person that we were just talking about.
Yeah.
So tell me, you know, what are your thoughts about that? You know, what do you think goes into that? How do you suggest somebody really overcome their own stuff so that they can support the people they love? Because there may be some risk involved with that.
Yeah. And I have a 3-step process. I think it's good to use in any situation. The first step is listen. Mm-hmm. My mom saved my life because she listened to me that night that I wanted to commit suicide. She listened without judging.
Right.
And what stop people and what close people off is often the judgment. So just listen without judging. The number 2 is reframe. Mm-hmm. So you say, oh, what I heard you saying is this, this, and that. Did right. I understand correctly?
Right. So the person knows that you've been truly listening.
Yeah.
In the therapy world, we call that active listening.
Okay. Yeah.
And absolutely. So the person knows that you've received their message. Message has been received. They got it.
And sometimes when you reframe and the person hear it from somebody else, that's where they click. They said, oh my God, that's not really what I want.
Right.
Really? And that reframing just bring them maybe to another way. And the 3rd step is questioning. To be sure, okay, now I understood well. Okay, what can you do to accomplish that? What else do you need to do? What is the next step? Just questioning. Because more you question and brainstorming, more you can help the other people. Even if you don't agree, and then that happens a lot with my clients, I don't agree with what
their
they want to do. But my job is really to help them to be sure that it's exactly what they want. And the questioning and the brainstorming portion is just bringing something new often into their head, because talking about it, it's where you make that round, you kind of refine
right.
everything.
Well, I love that, because what you're saying is that really you want to be a good supporter, and even that's almost really what a good coach does. So it's actually training people how to really listen. So reflect back so that the person really can hear what they were communicating and make sure you got it right. And to ask questions just to start stimulating thinking and brainstorming and all those things. I also think, and I just think this is true, it is. Everybody may have their opinion about somebody's goals, you know, and people who have big goals are very passionate.
Yeah.
And they're very excited. And I feel like even if it ends up one day that they say, okay, I thought I could do that and do this, but maybe I can't do both, or I thought it would happen in 6 months. Whoops. Going to take a little bit more time. Whatever it is, that instead of judging that you understand that the passion and the excitement is half of it.
Yeah.
I mean, I think people who are dreamers and have big dreams, they feed off that excitement. That really is what gives them purpose. It makes them feel alive.
Yeah.
And whether they achieve that goal exactly the way they had intended, whether they achieve it in the time frame, whether they fall on their behinds over and over and over again and finally one day say, all right, let's move on to a new goal.
Yeah.
That when you love someone, you're there to say, well, you know what? Good for you that you tried.
Yeah.
And never to make someone feel bad for going for a dream.
Yeah.
I just think that's really important.
And I don't know who said that, but it's not the destination who is important. It's the journey.
It's all about the journey.
And like motorcycle racing, yes, that's fun to cross the finish line. But that would not be fun just crossing the finish line. What is fun is racing. I go into the corner and just dance with your bike, dance with your life, dance with your challenge.
Yeah.
Whatever happened, if somebody crash into you and your bike is just flip up, you need to get up and you need to to regain that confidence and redo. So it's why I really like the analogy of motorcycle racing. And if people can see my video on my website, you will really feel that if you dance with your bike and dance with your life and smile in your helmet, mm-hmm. even if it's rainy outside, you need to take the start. Right. There are so many things that people can do, but they don't do it because they are afraid. Mm-hmm. And they don't take the start.
Right. And I think that fear stops it from both ends. It's like we can be afraid to fail. We can be afraid to get hurt. We can be, you know, we can be afraid of all these things when going for it. Because honestly, if you live a big life, you get big everything. You know what I mean? You get big successes. You get big
challenges.
Big
too.
Challenges. You get, you know, big bruises. You get, you know, it's big. It's all of it's big.
Yeah.
And to support the people that you love in their dreams, you know, there's risks involved with that too. I think people get scared. Like, oh my gosh, if they reach their dream, will they still want me? Well, is there a loss here for me? Is there a risk for me? And I think that's a lot of why people hold other people back. And any dream. I don't care. It doesn't have to be big or small. I mean, really, if your dream and goal is to lose 5 pounds, you know, that's as valuable of a dream as it is to win the Daytona, whatever yeah. that's called.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it really doesn't matter. It's yours. And if it's important to you, that's all that counts. And don't let anybody judge it from that perspective. And in turn, try not to judge other people's dreams as well, because, you know, we all want to feel what it's like to, you know, have something and go for something and feel that purpose and that mission. And
yeah.
So I, yeah.
And the problem in the society right now is when people cannot reach their dream, they stop dreaming.
Right.
And when you stop dreaming, you start dying.
Yeah. I agree.
Even if it's just having a garden.
Exactly.
In your place, or even if it's just going to cinema with your children once a week.
Right.
Or whatever always, dream it is.
Yeah. Or I always wanted to, you know, take up tennis or whatever it is. You know, I heard a tennis player that had a really interesting saying too. They said, if you're a professional tennis player and you only live for the tournaments, like that's your goal, you're in big trouble. You have to love the practice.
Yeah.
That's what I said. If you don't love the day-to-day practice of playing tennis, you're in the wrong business, because it's not even about, I mean, yeah, being on center court at Wimbledon is, you know, that may be the big dream of every tennis player, but very few people get there, number one. And when you get there, that's just one moment in time. It, you know, you've got hours and hours and hours that it took to get you there. That's the whole thing. You better enjoy the journey.
Yeah.
And, you know, make the journey. The yeah. journey is what counts. And then be surprised at what's at the end of the
yeah. And we can bring that back also to the relationship.
Oh, absolutely.
The day to day, the practice, the adjustment, the compromising. You need to enjoy that.
Yes, yes.
Because it's part of life.
That's absolutely right. And so in closing, I want you to go for it, make your dreams a priority. And certainly support the dreams of those that you love, because that's what makes our lives, I think, rich and lively and full of life and passion. So, Nadine, first of all, I can't thank you for being here.
You've
been such a pleasure. And before we go, how can people find you? Again, I'll just remind people, you can always find Nadine on my blog at julieorlov.com. Go to the radio show icon, press on that. You'll get all the information and a link to Nadine. But tell our viewers how they can get in touch with you.
The people can get in touch with me at nadineracing.com. And you can have a different free gift there. And I'm going to speak to the American Sales Summit along with the top 30 speakers in the country in Las Vegas. And if you want free tickets for that 4-day event, I have that on my website too. So nadineracing.com, and hopefully to see you soon.
Yeah, go there. She's got all kinds of great stuff on there. And that's such a nice perk. Have a little trip to Vegas. There
yes.
you go. All right. And then, of course, if you need to reach me for anything, you can always contact me at julieorlov.com or 1-888-99-PATHS. Again, I'm here every week and every day if you need me to help you create very strong and intimate relationships in every area of your life. Thank you again for being here. You've been such a pleasure.
Thank you.
I thank all of you for joining us here on Pathways to Love. I look forward to seeing you next Sunday. Have a great week, everyone.
Thanks.